Good morning, everybody. In this lecture, I will try to explain the use of cancer biomarkers in medicine with emphasis on the newest cancer biomarker to be discovered, which is called cell-free DNA. I will break this lecture into a number of parts so that you can follow up the content more easily. First, I will define what is a biomarker, not just a cancer biomarker, but any type of a biomarker. According to the National Institute of Health, biomarkers are characteristics that are objectively measured and evaluated as an indicator of normal biological processes, pathogenic processes, or pharmacologic responses to a therapeutic intervention. Biomarkers are not just used in medicine, but in many areas, including even in toxicology and criminality. As you can see from the attached figure, there is a dead body, and the various biomarkers that are used there are blood stains, hair, and other indicators that may lead to the resolution of the crime. You may wonder what a biomarker could be. Biomarkers can be anything from a metabolite such as creatinine, which is used to check for kidney function, troponin, used to identify myocardial infarction, a nucleic acid with a mutation or other molecular change, an enzyme like PSA, adhesion molecules, transcripts, pictures, slides, stained or unstained, symptoms such as abdominal pain, cell type or shape. So in brief, a biomarker could be anything you can imagine. In the field of biomarkers, some of these molecules, biomarkers such as troponin, work for all patients. For example, if somebody has an elevation in troponin, almost invariably, this is associated with a myocardial infarction, or if somebody has elevated hemoglobin A1C, invariably has diabetes mellitus. Some other biomarkers only work for a fraction of patients, such as according to disease subtype or severity, and some other biomarkers work for only very few patients, and in our laboratory, we identified first these markers and named them personalized biomarkers. How are we using biomarkers in medicine? Some of the applications are shown in the slide and include screening of asymptomatic individuals as an aid to diagnosis, which means patients already have symptoms, in prognosis, which means that we know that the patients have the disease, but we want to predict their future outcome, in predicting therapeutic response, which means before therapy starts, we want to know if the drug will work or not, in predicting toxicity before giving the therapy, and in monitoring the treatment of success over time in patients during therapeutic interventions. These are some of the major uses of biomarkers in medicine. You may also wonder, a as to where do we measure these biomarkers. The most usual fluid for measuring biomarkers is blood, and especially the derivatives of blood, plasma or serum. But biomarkers can also be measured in urine, sputum, synovial fluid, seminal plasma, cerebrospinal fluid, tissues, and other fluids. On the right side of the slide, it is shown how we obtain serum or plasma from whole blood. After venipuncture, the tube of blood is usually spun at around 3000 G for about 15 minutes, after which time the tube has three layers: the red blood cells on the bottom, the white blood cells in the interface, and a yellow fluid, clear fluid on top, which is called serum if no anticoagulant is used, or plasma if we use anticoagulant like heparin in the tube. For practical purposes, in most cases, serum or plasma are considered to be equivalent fluids. I would now change gears and explain some important definitions that are necessary for you to understand the use of tumor markers. One attribute is called disease prevalence. And in epidemiology, prevalence is defined as a proportion of a particular population found to be affected by a medical condition. For example, in the left side of the slide, we show 10 people, 9 in black font and 1 in red, which indicates that there is one patient out of 10 that has the disease. This is the prevalence of the disease and is defined as the number of cases or patients divided by the number of all persons. On the right side of the slide, you can see that the red people are diseased and the prevalence is well below 10%. And in a much larger population, the prevalence can be even lower. For cancer, the usual prevalence in the general population, of course, varies with the type of cancer, but is usually 1% or less, which means that cancer, although we all know about it, is a relatively uncommon disease if we consider the whole population in our discussion. Since biomarkers are used in medicine, they have other attributes which are very important in showing how good these biomarkers are. One of these attributes is called sensitivity and is defined as to how many disease patients are positive for the marker out of all the disease patients. For example, if you have 100 patients with cancer and the test is positive in 90% of them, the sensitivity of the test is obviously 90%. Another important attribute is how many of the normal subjects are negative for the disease. Ideally, we want all normal people to be negative, such as specificity of 100%. But usually this is not the case because some normal people may show abnormal results. This means that if 5 out of 100 normal people are negative, are positive for the disease, that is false positives, the specificity is defined at 95%. Another important attribute is called positive predictive value and is defined as the chances of somebody who is positive for a test to have the disease. For example, if the positive predictive value is 50%, it means that if somebody does the test, diseased or non-diseased, and is positive, then it has 50% chance of having the disease. The negative predictive value is the opposite, which means your chances of not having the disease if you're negative. And if, for example, the negative predictive value is 95%, it means that if you do the test and you're negative, your chances of not having the disease is 95%. I know from many years of teaching that students find some difficulty in understanding these characteristics, but I suggest that you read for them more than once so that you can digest the meaning of these important characteristics of tumor markers. Otherwise, you will not be able to understand how we use them in the clinic. The next slide shows the relationship between sensitivity and specificity of any test, including cancer biomarkers. You can see with the blue lines the distribution of tests in a patient population without the disease and in a population of patients who have the disease. And there is obviously an overlap. The dotted line shows something that we call cutoff, which means that if you are less than the cutoff, you don't have, the test is negative. And if you are on the right side of the dotted line, the test is positive. We can have four different possibilities with these results, as you can see. The true negatives are people without the disease who are negative for the test. The false negatives are people who are negative for the test, but they are patients. The true positives are people who have the disease and they are positive for the biomarker. And the false positives are people who don't have the disease and they are positive for the biomarker. Ideally, as you can see from the right side of the slide, we want no overlap in results between the patients and the patient without the disease. But usually there is an overlap. And as you can realize also from the slide, by selecting the appropriate cutoff, we can manipulate the sensitivity and the specificity of the test. One thing that you need to remember is that as we are maximizing sensitivity, that is reducing the cutoff, the specificity is reduced. And the opposite is also true. If we want to maximize specificity by moving the cutoff to the right, the sensitivity is reduced. So please remember, there is an inverse relationship between sensitivity and specificity. According to the cutoff, maximizing sensitivity makes the specificity poorer, and maximizing the specificity makes the sensitivity poorer. In the next slide, I will try to confuse you a little bit more with some more definitions, but these are simple definitions for people like you, graduate students. So a true positive result is a result which means that the person has the disease and the test is positive. The true negative means that the people does not have the disease and the test is negative. The false positives refers to people who do not have the disease, but the test is positive. And the false negative means that are people who have the disease, but the test is negative. These definitions are important, as you will see later in the presentation. I will now return back to the predictive value of the test. As I defined it before, the positive predictive value means that is the chance of having the disease if you do a test and the test is positive, and is mathematically defined as the ratio of the true positives divided by all the positives, which means the true positives and the false positives. The negative predictive value represents your chances of not having the disease if the test is negative, and is mathematically defined as the true negative divided by all the negatives, meaning the true negatives and the false negatives. I would now show you a classical example which shows that the positive predictive value of a test and the negative predictive value of a test is highly dependent on disease prevalence. That is, how common is a disease among the general population. In this slide, you see that we have 1,000 individuals, of which 100 in blue have the disease, which means the prevalence is 10%. If we apply a test with 100% sensitivity and 90% specificity, you will calculate that there will be 100 true positives, 81 false positives, 819 true negatives, and zero false negatives. If we apply the equation for the positive predictive value, you will find out that the positive predictive value in this scenario is 55%, which means that if we test any of these 1,000 people and the test is positive, their chances of having the disease is 55%. The negative predictive value, according to the equation that I use, is 100%, which means if you are negative, your chances of having the disease are zero. Now, in the next scenario, I portray the same population, but the prevalence is much less at 1%. If you apply the same calculation, you will find out that there will be 10 true positives, 99 false positives, 891 true negatives, zero false negatives, and the positive predictive value will be 9%, and the negative predictive value will be 100%. This example shows that only by changing the prevalence from 10% to 1%, if you're positive for the test, your chances of having the disease is reduced from 55% to 9%. The situation becomes even worse if the prevalence of the disease is much less at 0.1%, which is the usual prevalence for many cancers and other rare diseases. You can then see that only one blue caricature out of the 1,000 has actually the disease. And if you apply the test with the same sensitivity and specificity as before and make the calculations again, you will find out that the positive predictive value in this case is 1% and the negative predictive value is 100%. Summarized in the next slide shows that if the prevalence is 10% and the test has 100% sensitivity and 90% specificity, the positive predictive value is 55%, that is the chances of having the disease if you are positive are quite high. But if the prevalence is lower at 1%, your chances are 9% of having the disease. And if the prevalence is 0.1%, the chances of having the disease if you're positive are reduced to 1%. This one shows the classical knowledge that it is far more difficult to identify a rare disease with a biochemical test than it is to identify a common disease with a biochemical test. And as I said before, since cancer is a relatively rare disease with prevalence in the 1% or less area, the test that we use to detect the cancer early must have outstanding sensitivity, close to 100%, and outstanding specificity, close to 100%. Otherwise, the so-called positive predictive value, which I repeat, is your chances of having the disease if you're positive, will be very low, and so low sometimes that is useless for clinical practice. I know that these examples will confuse you, but I suggest that you go back and you do the calculations on your own to understand very well that as the disease prevalence is becoming lower, rare disease, the chances of finding those who have the disease with biochemical tests are much less than if we are dealing with a common disease. In the next slide, I summarize some very famous blood serum biomarkers that have been discovered between 30 and 100 years ago. This underlines the fact that most biomarkers that we use today have actually been discovered a long time ago. I'm sure you're all familiar with hemoglobin A1c, which is a biomarker of diabetes, troponin, which is a biomarker of myocardial infarction and other cardiac diseases, creatinine, the oldest biomarker we are using for over 100 years to check for the kidney function, the aminotransferases, AST and ALP, to check for the function of the liver, the hormone TSH to check the thyroid, the hormone PTH to check for the parathyroid function, the blood pressure for hypertension, hemoglobin for anemia, and the famous prostate-specific antigen, which is used to diagnose and monitor prostate cancer. Some of the most famous cancer biomarkers now, which are currently used in the clinic and have also been discovered between 30 and 100 years ago, include carcinoembryonic antigen, which was described for the first time in Montreal by Canadian investigator Phil Gold, alpha fetoprotein, which is used to diagnose liver and testicular cancer, the cancer antigen CA125 discovered in the 1980s to diagnose ovarian cancer, They got a cancer antigen 19.9 for pancreatic cancer, cancer antigen 15.3 for breast cancer, PSA for prostate cancer, cytokeratin fragments for breast and lung cancer, hormone receptors for breast cancer, and human chorionic gonadotropin, which is used to diagnose testicular cancer. I will now move on to describe some other aspects of cancer that you should be aware of. The last 10 years, with the advent of single cell sequencing, it has become very evident that cancer is a very heterogeneous disease. In fact, we can say that the cancer of each individual patient is probably very unique. And we are very much well aware that cancers can arise at different tissues, at any tissue in that respect. Cancers can originate from various cell types within a single tissue, such as breast cancer has two or three different subtypes. There are also specific histological types of cancers, like the ovarian cancer has four histological types. It has also been discovered recently that different founder mutations are present in various cancer cells. There are diversity of mutations between the progeny and the daughter cells. And clinically, the cancers behave very differently. Some of them are very aggressive and some of them are much less aggressive. So remember that we are not dealing with one disease, but with a group of diseases that are characterized by great heterogeneity. You should also remember that this great heterogeneity of cancer allows the cancer to develop drug resistance by emergence of certain subclones within the cancer mass. In the next slide, I show a schematic of cancer progression with the development of tremendous heterogeneity. The current theories of cancer development suggest that cancer originates from a single cell which proliferates slowly but steadily, and eventually daughter cells develop specific mutations that are different from the original cell. And as the cancer grows and expands, there is proliferation of various cancer cells which are characterized by specific mutations. So please remember that cancer is very heterogeneous in terms of its mutational spectrum. I will now turn my attention to part two of this presentation. I will now move to the next part of the presentation, which will cover in detail the latest and very fashionable new cancer biomarker, which is called circulating tumor DNA or circulating cell-free DNA. The story of circulating free DNA started in the early 1990s when my friend and colleague Dennis Law, shown in the picture, with me in South Africa in 2017, where we shared an award, identified for the first time that fetal cell-free DNA is present in the blood of pregnant women at the level of 5 to 10%. Dennis went on to develop very important applications of circulating free DNA in pregnancy and develop a non-invasive method for the detection of fetuses which have chromosomal abnormalities such as Down syndrome. This non-invasive prenatal testing is now the standard of care in many countries, including Canada. It was a major discovery related to pregnancy. The concept of using circulating fetal DNA for detection of chromosomal abnormalities is shown in the figure. As you can see, in normal fetus, you can find a number of copies from chromosome 21 and two copies per fragment of DNA in normal cases. However, when the fetus has trisomy 21, the representation of chromosome 21 in the cell-free DNA is higher, as shown in the figure. This is done by sequencing fragments of chromosome 21 and comparing the numbers. Obviously, fetuses with three chromosome 21 will be overrepresented, and this is the way to discriminate between a normal fetus and a fetus with trisomy 21 or other trisomies by comparing the number of transcripts that have been number of DNA fragments that have been sequenced. It is not the purpose of this lecture to get into the details of prenatal diagnosis of fetal abnormalities, but this procedure is known also as liquid biopsy. As we all know, the so-called tissue biopsy, which is an invasive procedure, includes cutting and examining tissues from patients to identify abnormalities by using microscopic pathological techniques. The liquid biopsy is a non-invasive way of doing the same by using blood, plasma or serum of patients with various diseases, liquid biopsy. As shown in the next slide, liquid biopsy, unlike tissue biopsy, which is done with a needle or during surgery, the liquid biopsy involves obtaining blood or other fluids and then analyze them, and is a minimally invasive procedure. With the same principle, you can analyze circulating tumor DNA, tumor cells, exosomes, and other fragments. As I already mentioned, liquid biopsy does not apply only to circulating peripheral blood and the tube that is shown in the slide, but it can also be applied to ascites fluid, stool, urine, pleural fluid, saliva, and cerebrospinal fluid. We now come to the important question as to what is the origin of circulating tumor DNA, which, as I said, is used for the liquid biopsy diagnostics. The circulating tumor DNA is DNA that originates from cancer cells, and it has been shed into the bloodstream. The amount of circulating tumor DNA is obviously proportional to tumor size. We have to remember here that healthy cells are also releasing cell-free DNA into the circulation. And if you examine the amount of circulating free DNA that is present in the circulation of a normal individual, you will find that the amount is approximately 1 to 10 nanograms per milliliter. The circulating DNA is fragmented to about 150 to 200 nucleotides. There is a range for this due to proteolytic digestion of larger length DNA. In the next slide, I show diagrammatically how the DNA, which is prepackaged in chromatin, can be fragmented at various places, generating a heterogeneous group of fragments between 160 and 180 to 220 nucleotides long. There is heterogeneity in the fragmentation in both healthy individuals and persons with cancer. It has been mentioned by many people that the circulating tumor DNA is the ultimate personalized biomarker, and this is so because the circulating tumor DNA represents relatively accurately the mutations that are present in the tumor. So, if you retrieve circulating tumor DNA from the circulation non-invasively, you can use it for analyzing for mutations on other genetic abnormalities, thus the circulating tumor DNA acting as a proxy of the tumor DNA, which is difficult and invasive to obtain. In the next slide, I show the genetic abnormalities that can be present in circulating tumor DNA and include point mutations, copy number alterations, gene fusions, or DNA methylation patterns. It is important here to realize that as the amount of circulating tumor DNA is diminished, which means that you're trying to identify smaller tumors, the difficulty in studying such DNA is increasing exponentially, and it is well known that when the percent of circulating tumor DNA in comparison to all of the circulating free DNA is less than 0.1%, then you need very elaborate and highly sensitive technologies to identify the genetic alterations. So remember, the smaller the tumor, the smaller the percentage of circulating tumor DNA, and the greater the difficulty in analyzing it by using molecular techniques. In the subsequent slide, I summarize the same thing that I mentioned already, that the circulating tumor DNA is retrieved from serum that is obtained after venous puncture and then is extracted, amplified, and used for diagnosis. As I already mentioned, you need highly specific techniques in order to analyze tumor DNA that is represented by less than 0.1% in comparison to the total DNA. In the next slide, I reemphasize that when you obtain blood from an individual who has cancer, you will retrieve normal DNA, which is the great majority, and tumor DNA, and the two types of DNAs can be distinguished by the genetic alterations, such as mutations, epigenetic changes, etc. The ratio of the cancer to normal DNA expresses a percentage is known in the literature as a mutant allele fraction. And obviously, the higher the tumor volume, the higher the mutant allele fraction, and the easier the analysis. As I already emphasized, when the mutant allele fraction is very low, less than 0.1%, we need very special techniques to reliably analyze circulating tumor DNA in the presence of vast majority of normal DNA. Now, in part three of my presentation, I will show you some clinical applications of circulating tumor DNA. I will now present to you some major applications of circulating tumor DNA. One of the best applications, which actually is now well established, is related to the prognosis. In 2016, a study of 230 stage 2 colon cancer patients has shown that 100% of those patients who had detectable circulating tumor DNA right after the surgery relapsed later. On the contrary, more than 90% of patients whose circulating tumor DNA disappeared and became negative did not relapse. This shows that the presence of circulating tumor DNA after surgery is a bad prognostic indicator of the disease, and these data have been confirmed in many studies. Other studies have tried to establish the value of circulating tumor DNA for monitoring disease during therapy. And as you can see in the slide, there is a comparison between circulating tumor DNA in blue line, circulating tumor marker CA15-3, the green line, and circulating tumor cells, which is the orange line, in patients with breast cancer. As you can see, the circulating tumor DNA was able to go down after a bilirubin treatment and then go up again, triggering the initiation of therapy with letrozole and a bilirubin when the DNA went down. This data show, but not very convincingly, that circulating tumor DNA can be used to monitor the therapy response in patients with various cancer, in this case, breast cancer. The following slide shows the use of circulating tumor DNA in monitoring the success of treatment. The patient under discussion was studied through circulating tumor DNA for presence of mutations at initial stages and a number of mutations have been identified. Now, during therapy, those patients who responded have shown absence of mutations or dramatic reduction in the mutational number, while patients who were progressing have shown no decrease or increase in the number of mutations. The identification of patients who are not responding to therapies can trigger selection of new therapies. So this application shows that sequencing of circulating tumor DNA can inform the choice of therapy to target specific mutations. Other studies have shown, as I have indicated before, that the amount of circulating tumor DNA correlates relatively well with tumor volume, and it is possible by using circulating tumor DNA analysis to get an idea of how much tumor is present in a patient, thus estimating roughly the tumor size. I will now go to part four of my presentation and discuss in some detail the most important and clinically useful application of circulating tumor DNA for early diagnosis. As I have already told you, circulating tumor DNA is useful unequivocally for patient prognosis, patient monitoring, and related applications. However, the use of circulating tumor DNA for early diagnosis of cancer is still highly controversial, and our laboratory has done some work which has been published recently in this area, as I will explain to you now. Here I mention that the application of early cancer diagnosis is a very important area of investigation over the last 50 years because it is widely known that if the cancer is diagnosed early, the cure rates are much higher than the cure or prolongation of life in patients who have advanced tumors. One of the companies that was recently formed to study circulating tumor DNA for early cancer diagnosis goes by the name of GRAIL. The company GRAIL was created by major investments by highly known individuals such as Bill Gates, Amazon, Johnson & Johnson, and Illumina, who have invested over $1 billion to succeed in diagnosing early cancer by using circulating tumor DNA, showing you the great interest in this area. In their efforts to promote their research, the GRAIL company engaged into sequencing circulating free DNA in more than 10,000 individuals with cancer and more than 3,000 healthy individuals. The numbers are still increasing, in order to find out if the differences between the sequencing of individuals with cancer and healthy individuals are enough and robust enough to diagnose cancer at an early stage. Some of the molecular technologies that GRAIL has used to compare differences between normal DNA and cancer DNA includes targeted sequencing of 507 genes previously associated with cancer, whole genome sequencing for copy number variations, whole genome bisulfite sequencing for studying methylation differences between normal and cancerous DNA, and genome-wide fragmentation studies to identify altered fragmentation profiles in patients with or without cancer. After evaluating all these molecular technologies, the great company came to the conclusion that studying methylation differences is the best method to use in their diagnostic efforts. The principle of bisulfite difference sequencing relies on the fact that if you treat DNA with bisulfite, this treatment converts cytosines to uracil but leaves the methylated cytosines unaffected. Therefore, the DNA that has been treated with bisulfite retains only methylated cytosines. And as you can see from the slide, by using sequencing before and after bisulfite, you can identify the origin of the DNA. Apart from diagnostic companies such as Grail, academic groups have also tried to identify early cancer by using circulating tumor DNA. For example, the group of Victor Verculescu at Johns Hopkins University tried to identify early stage cancer using circulating tumor DNA sequencing, and they found that their method, after evaluating 200 patients of various cancers, had sensitivities in the range of 70% in patients with stage 1 or 2 disease. These data are highly promising because it shows that a specificity of about 98%, the sensitivity of this method could be in the range of 70%. In our own critique of this paper, we have shown that the relatively good results with this technology are due to the fact that the authors have already used patients with advanced cancers, since the mutant allele fraction of circulating tumor DNA in all of their cases exceeded 0.1%. And as I have indicated before, tumors patients with mutant allele fraction less than 0.1% are much more difficult to study. So the study was biased with the fact that the authors have used patients with relatively high mutant allele fraction. In another academic effort to diagnose cancer by using circulating tumor DNA by the Greek principal investigator Nicholas Papadopoulos, combined circulating tumor DNA analysis with classical tumor markers that we used in the lab for 50 years, and they found in the paper they published in Science in 2018 that they can achieve sensitivities between 70 and 98% according to the cancer type at a specificity of 99%. These sensitivities and specificities are in fact highly impressive if the results that they are publishing can be reproduced by other investigators. The paper by Nicholas Papadopoulos et al. In Science 2018 gave me the opportunity to appear in the Canadian television commenting on the advantages and disadvantages of this important paper. Nicholas Papadopoulos, shown in the picture with me last year, collaborated to develop a company called Thrive in May 2019 with the aim of bringing an inexpensive test for early tumor detection based on the paper that I already mentioned. Nicholas was able to raise $110 million and he licensed his technology to Thrive Company. As I mentioned earlier, the motto of Thrive, Grail, and other companies who are dealing with similar technologies is that earlier detection can lead to earlier and more successful interventions, thus succeeding better clinical outcomes of patients with cancer. In another effort, the academic group of Victor Verculescu published a paper in Nature in May 2019 in which they exploited the differences in fragmentation patterns in patients with cancer regarding circulating tumor DNA in comparison to people who have no cancer. In this paper, the authors report highly impressive sensitivities in the order of 57 to more than 99% among seven cancer types at the impressive specificity of 98%. As I mentioned earlier, these data need to be validated before they become believable. In order to further investigate the circulating tumor DNA for early cancer detection, I collaborated with my student Claire Fiala and made some important calculations regarding the amount of circulating tumor DNA and the likely success of early cancer detection of small tumors. I take this opportunity to mention to all of you that it looks simple but is rather difficult to challenge papers published in Science and Nature, and when you do so, you have to be careful, be confident with what you say, because if you are wrong, you will pay a heavy price, but if you are correct, you will be rewarded. I also remind you for the history that during my career in the last 20 years, I challenged a lot of people who have came up with seemingly amazing diagnostic methods, some of them shown in the slide, and I am proud to say that in most, if not all of the cases, the challenges that we mounted on these new technologies have been successful, which means that most of the published data did not survive external validation. In the next few slides, I portray some of the published work on challenging the use of circulating tumor DNA for early cancer detection in various journals, the most important and thorough analysis published in BMC Medicine in year 2018, and it is one of our most highly cited papers. In our critique of the papers published regarding circulating tumor DNA for early cancer diagnosis, we use pregnancy as an example and as a proxy of the presence of the tumor because the fetus is an exogenous entity. And we know from the extensive literature of circulating free DNA in pregnancy that the fetal DNA, it constitutes approximately 10% of the total cell-free DNA that is found in pregnant women. In the first part of our analysis, we calculated that the amount of cell-free DNA in normal individuals, it ranges between 1 to 10 nanograms per milliliter, which is equivalent to approximately 3,000 complete genomes per milliliter of plasma. We have also assumed that in maternal screening programs that usually take place about 10 to 20 weeks gestation, the fetal DNA makes up about 5 to 10% of total cell-free DNA. By using these numbers, we constructed a table which correlates the weight of the fetus or the placental unit to the percent fetal DNA in maternal plasma to the whole fetal cancer genome equivalence per 4 milliliter of plasma, which is equivalent to a 10 milliliter blood tube, and the number of malignant cells that may be present there. And you can see that at the level of 1 gram, the mutant allele fraction is 0.02%. The ratio of fetal to maternal DNA is 1 in 5,000. And there are 2 whole genome equivalents per tube of blood. This number is important because it shows that if the amount of cancer falls below 1 gram, such as 100 milligram, in one tube of blood, there will be less than 1 whole genome equivalent, which means that we cannot analyze this DNA because it will likely not be present in one tube of blood. By using these numbers, we concluded that by using such analysis and a 10 milliliter tube of blood, it is unlikely to detect any tumor that is less than 12.5 millimeters in diameter, because the amount of circulating tumor DNA will be less than 1 genome equivalent. In the next slide, we present a simplified summary of our data, which show that if you have a 10 gram or 10 milliliter tumor, which has a diameter of 27 millimeters, the mutant allele fraction will be 0.1%. The number of equivalent genomes per 10 milliliter of blood will be 6, and the likelihood of detecting the tumor will be relatively high. But if the tumor is smaller at 12.5 millimeters in diameter, you will be at the threshold of detectability because there will only be one whole genome equivalent of DNA in the circulation. And if the tumor diameter falls below 12 millimeter, like 6 millimeter, it is highly unlikely to detect such tumors because there will not be enough circulating tumor DNA to do the analysis. Although I do not mention it in detail here, I can reassure you that all the published studies with the sensitivities and specificities that they achieve at certain mutant allele fraction have corroborated our calculations on all occasions. Although I presented it about 1 hour ago, we are now turning our attention not only to sensitivity, but to specificity. And in this slide, we show that in screening programs, such as in mammograms and PSA testing, the specificity of the test, which means false positivity rate, is very important and has to be extremely low for a screening program to be successful. As I have indicated before, the specificity of any cancer detection test is of paramount importance. It was originally thought that normal individuals do not have any mutations in their circulating DNA. However, recent studies have identified a precancerous condition called clonal hematopoiesis, in which about 1% of individuals under the age of 40 and 10 to 20% of individuals over the age of 70 harbor mutations in some genes. While these mutations may be consequential in most people, a small percentage of these individuals develop hematologic malignancies in the future, period. The importance of clonal hematopoiesis in the detection of cancer by using circulating DNA is that identified mutations in the circulating DNA may be indicative of clonal hematopoiesis and not to the presence of cancer at another site. This finding that clonal hematopoiesis can manifest with mutations in circulating DNA reduces the specificity of the cancer test by using circulating free DNA and compromises its positive predictive value. The development of clonal hematopoiesis is shown diagrammatically in the next slide, whereby very early in life, some hematopoietic cells harbor mutations followed by dissemination of mutations in a condition called clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential. As time goes by, this condition can develop to something that is known as myelodysplastic syndrome, and eventually a small percentage of these individuals will develop acute myeloid leukemia. As you can see from the right side of the slide, a number of genes are found to have mutations in hematopoietic cells, including RUNX1, IDH1, IDH2, etc. In a recent study by Razavi et al. In Nature Medicine, it was revealed that only 24% of circulating tumor DNA mutations are also found in matched tumor tissue. And they have also shown that 80%, in 80% of cases, the circulating tumor DNA harbor mutations that match those of white blood cell DNA. And these mutations are due to clonal hematopoiesis, not cancer. One way to alleviate this very important limitation is to also do sequencing of white blood cell DNA, and the mutations that are found in circulating tumor DNA compared to these mutations to exclude or rule in the presence of mutations in non-white blood cell DNA. While, as I mentioned earlier, we assume that mutations are accompanied with cancerous tissue, recent new evidence over the last 2 to 3 years have confirmed that normal tissues can harbor DNA mutations without necessarily being cancerous. This phenomenon has been studied especially in the esophageal epithelium, where it has been found that this epithelium, even in people without cancer, can harbor a number of mutations which can proliferate with the consumption of alcohol, tobacco, and other drinks. In order to explain this paradox, a paper in Science recently has postulated that normal cells which harbor mutations, they may not be able to afford the expense of energy to repair the mutations, but rather they allow the mutations to coexist without necessarily being progressed to cancer. In order to address this issue in greater detail, my associate Claire Fiala and myself recently published a review paper in BMC Medicine outlining situations whereby normal tissues harbor mutations that they resemble cancer. It is very clear from these conclusions that normal tissues and fluids may contain mutations that do not show the presence of cancer, thus compromising the specificity of tests that are based on mutations to identify presence of cancer by using circulating tumor DNA. Other related papers on the same issue, such as the one appeared in Science, speculate that certain tissues, especially the brain, develop mutations in a small percentage of neurons, and these mutations may have physiological relevance in the functioning of these neurons without necessarily indicating that these neurons are either in preneoplastic or neoplastic stage. We have also need to keep in mind that trying to identify cancer by using elaborate genetic testing in circulating tumor DNA is technically difficult and expensive, and it requires highly specific expertise. Consequently, the people who are engaged in this type of diagnostic procedures, they must have the proper instrumentation, technologies, and expertise to conduct the tests appropriately. In the last slide of my presentation, I show you a number of different scenarios when an individual decides to perform a circulating tumor DNA test in plasma for detection of cancer. The outcome of this test could be a true positive, that is, molecular changes are identified in a patient with occult cancer. In this case, the patient will get the benefit because of the early diagnosis, early treatment, and fortunately, better clinical outcomes. Another possibility, which is usually not mentioned widely, is that the test may be positive, but it may be false positive, which means that the person has no cancer, has a precancerous lesion, or a lesion that is not going to pose a threat to the patient's life. In this case, you have to remember that such tests will likely be repeated and probably unnecessary interventions such as possible exposure to radiation, harmful procedures and drugs, increasing anxiety and cost are major factors. Another possibility of such a test is that the test will be equivocal because of the lack of adequate DNA to do a proper analysis. In such cases, the patient who is not going to take a definitive answer for the test will be left wondering if he or she has cancer or not. Another possibility is that the test is false negative, which means that the patient has cancer, but the test did not show any abnormalities. In such situations, these patients will be falsely reassured that they don't have cancer, but in actual reality they do. The cancer will then spread and become symptomatic, and the patients will likely go to the courts and sue the people who did the test because they were declared to be negative for cancer. Another possibility, of course, is that the test is negative in a patient that doesn't have cancer, and in such case, there will be no action necessary. In closing this long presentation, I would like to thank my longtime collaborators Claire Fiala, Annie Wren, Dorsa Sohai, and Kaitlyn DiPaolo especially, who have helped me prepare the presentation and helped me with the narrative addition so that we can make this lecture informative to you at any time you want to listen to it again. Thank you very much for your attendance.